Swirling on the wind, an ending's coming.
Doubting Thomas by David McVey. The roar of breaking surf gave way to a hollow swirling and bubbling as his strength ebbed. He was engulfed by a cold, liquid blackness, darker even than the wild midnight above the waves. He exhaled salt water and gave himself up to the sea. When he opened his eyes, the darkness had changed. Halos of light were visible above the solid black of the sea wall. He was being held securely and drawn back towards the land. Still only semi-conscious, he dimly felt himself being hauled onto a wet, slimy slipway that angled into the water. His rescuer placed him in the recovery position and coaxed seawater from his lungs. He gave a violent, retching cough and passed out. In the days after he regained consciousness, he relished the warmth and light of the hospital wall, the vitality of the nursing staff, the firm, enveloping comfort of the bedclothes, the whole lexicon of life, the rich texture of the land of the living, seemed things to be craved. He determined never to let go of them. A man and a woman sat by the bed. The man he knew, his publisher, Ryan Savage. The woman, young, intelligent looking, had simply been introduced as Sarah. I was trying to reconcile a couple of points for the lecture I was giving, he was telling them. I didn't find the hotel room very conducive, so I thought I'd go for a walk. At midnight? Asked Savage. Yes, he smiled. Often do that. Whole chapters of God's obituary were written in my head during late night walks. Anyway, I went down to the seafront. It was a wild night. High tide. No one else was about. Just as I reached the sea wall, there was a huge gust of wind which knocked me over, and a colossal wave seemed to suck me under. I struggled in that sea. I thought the lights were going out for good. No word of your mysterious rescuer yet, by the way, said Savage. Not a soul has come forward. Perhaps we should offer a reward. It's such a fantastic chance. What a long shot that someone was out on such a night, saw me in the dark, and had the pluck and the ability to get me out. Someone really special. A sort of angel? Offered Sarah. Thomas Sowerby, the celebrated atheist, merely snorted. Sarah left soon afterwards. Nice girl, said Sowerby. Bright too. What does she do? She's a journalist, said Savage. I thought we might ask her to put out some kind of appeal for your benefactor to come forward. Good idea. Helpful publicity for the new book, if a little unorthodox. Next morning, a nurse shouted to Sowerby that he was in the paper and tossed a copy of the County Daily Echo onto his bed. He unfolded it and recognized his face on the front page. He began to read. God's obituary author saved by angel, by Sarah Michael. Mystery continues to surround the rescue of Thomas Sowerby, the militant atheist author saved from the sea at Dunthorpe during last Thursday night's gale. No one has been identified as the rescuer, and since the incident occurred late at night, in difficult conditions, Speculation is mounting that a supernatural element was involved. The Reverend Ronald States has written a book on modern angelic manifestations, and he believes Mr. Sowerby may have encountered a heavenly messenger. This was a remarkable escape for Mr. Sowerby, said Reverend States, and I think it quite likely that God has sent a rescuer as a sign to him to use his prodigious talents to more useful purpose. God has prepared him for some work, I'm sure. Every time the ward sister told Sowerby a newspaper reporter wanted to speak to him, and it happened several times that day, he barked, "I've got nothing to say." Weeks later, he sat in Savage's London office. "Amazing, isn't it?" Savage was saying. "All that publicity, every tabloid, TV, radio, and still, whoever rescued you hasn't come forward. There'll be a lot of interest in the new book." Sowerby did not smile. "What book? Who's going to credit a book written by an atheist when everyone thinks he owes his life to an angel?" Savage was quiet for a while, then glanced up at Sowerby and asked, "How are things going with the book, actually?" Sowerby looked away. "You did promise us that God's obituary was the start of a trilogy. We expected at least the first draft of Above the Sky Only by now." Sowerby took a deep breath, looked thoughtful for a moment, then said, "I can't concentrate on the book just now. Not until this thing is resolved. Until I find my rescuer and get them photographed and quoted by the press, I'll always be the skeptic who was saved by the God he doesn't believe in." Savage said slowly and deliberately, "You're going to sit in a kind of writer's limbo until this rescuer turns up? Suppose whoever it was got tugged back underwater after they pulled you onto the slipway. Have you thought about that? Let me put the PR hounds onto it. They can produce a rescuer from central casting." "Great thinking, Savage. What if the real hero emerges? Worse, sells his story to the press. You can see the headlines. Atheist author fakes non-existence of God." I've decided to book myself into a hotel in Dunthorpe, and I've hired a couple of inquiry agents. I don't care how much it costs. We'll go door to door. We'll build up a picture of everyone where they were in the town on that night, if we have to. We'll find him." Sowerby's voice rose sharply. After the two men had parted, Savage phoned his superior. "Nah, he didn't go for the publicity boy's idea. He's cracking up. I've given him another month. If that doesn't do it, we'll have to try and get hold of his notes and find a hack to ghost it." For 2 weeks, Sowerby lived in the echoing winter wastes of a Dunthorpe hotel. He did not use his own name, and a new growth of beard and shaggier hair kept him out of the public eye in a town where he was now well known. He grew well used to the wind-scoured streets and the narrow alleyways between rows of houses that smelt strongly of frying chips. Everywhere there was the tang of sea air, and every night from his window, Sowerby heard the surf, which might have been the last sound he ever heard. Some nights, it was a distant whisper, but more often it was a rumbling, wind-churned roar that went on into the night. Several times he shuddered suddenly awake. The surf roar reached a crescendo and the house shook. As the investigation continued, it became clear that most of Dunthorpe had been in bed by the hour of the rescue. Few hotels or boarding houses were willing to open their registers for the night in question. In any case, following up the names would have been a huge task. Sowerby switched his attention to the neighbouring village of Hutwistle. which lay just a mile inland, it was just possible that someone from there had been driving along Dunthorpe Promenade on the night. Perhaps they'd seen what had happened, or perhaps had been the saviour themselves. The main road ran just past the village, and a single minor road branched, gathered houses along itself, and became the main street of the village. As Sowerby walked along this street in the glowing gloom of a mid-December evening, he felt a new mood of well-being and purpose and triumph. It was difficult to explain this, but he had a real feeling that he was in the right place. This new stage of the investigation, he felt sure, would prove to be worthwhile and rewarding. There was something, a sense about this place. The main street was quiet. The only other person Sowerby could see was a stout lady with a dog that was sniffing around the base of a lamppost. It gave up its interest, and the pair made to cross the street, moving out of the aura of a light. Sowerby watched a car as it screamed round the corner of a distant bend, accelerated, and bore down on the woman. She had reached the middle of the road, but seemed transfixed with terror. The car started to brake. In only a few yards, it would strike the woman. Sowerby saw that she could not move, and he ran into the road, threw himself into the air, and grabbed the woman with both arms. They landed heavily, just short of the pavement. Sowerby lifted his eyes to see the car screech to a stop some distance away, from where the woman had fallen. The driver looked out, saw no movement from the two figures, and hurriedly drove off, tires squealing. Sowerby rose to his feet. The woman had bumped her head and was barely conscious, but there did not seem to be any serious damage. As her uninjured dog whimpered by her side, her hand lifted feebly to pet it. Sowerby, too, had sustained a blow to the head, and in his confusion, the only thing he could think about was returning to his hotel to rest. Sowerby woke up next morning with a severe headache and a vague sensation that the previous day had been an eventful one, yet he had no recollection of it. Over breakfast, he tried to recall the events of the preceding day. His body bore a galaxy of bruises, and his head throbbed. Had he been in some sort of trouble? One of his investigators arrived. "Would you believe it?" the man said, throwing a newspaper at Sowerby. "If we'd only got there half an hour earlier, we could have nipped this in the bud. Where were you, by the way?" It was an article in a national tabloid. Sowerby read, "New Angel Rescue in Yorkshire," by Sarah Michael. "Last night, in the sleepy Yorkshire village of Hutwhistle, Mrs. Gladys Arthur was wrenched from the path of a speeding car by a mysterious stranger. There is no doubt that the stranger saved her life, but he or she has not come forward. The incident happened just before 7 p.m. in the main street of the village."
"I was out walking Sparky my dog,"
said Mrs. Arthur, 52,
"when I crossed the main street. A car came out of nowhere, and I felt myself being pushed out of its path."
Mrs. Arthur bumped her head on the pavement and suffered concussion. The driver did not stop and has yet to be traced. Police inquiries are continuing. Mrs. Arthur is a member of the local Methodist church and adds,
"God sent an angel to rescue me. I've no doubts about that."
The incident occurred only a mile inland from the scene of the dramatic rescue of atheist writer Thomas Sowerby last month. also attributed to angelic intervention, though not by Mr. Sowerby. Sowerby finished his breakfast, went up to his room, and packed. He carried his cases downstairs and settled up at reception. As he waited at the station platform, all curiosity about his lost evening evaporated. It didn't matter. Nothing did. Certainly not the investigation. Angels were everywhere, and he was doomed to be seen as the atheist that God had believed in. God's obituary would remain a trilogy of one.
Up in the smoke, so